back in February, we managed to test a pre-production unit of the S1, and one thing we criticized was having to wait for the firmware update that was going to improve recording codecs and add Vlog. Well, the wait is finally over, but was it worth it? The very catchy DMW-SFU2 update is available now and seems to unlock the true potential of the S1. Alongside this paid upgrade, Panasonic also released a free firmware update for the S1 and the S1R. With firmware 1.2, Panasonic have claimed that they have improved the autofocus performance as well as the IBIS. The autofocus performance was one thing that we were critical of. For these new tests, we recorded in continuous autofocus and locked onto our subject. We did one with the subject slow walking, one medium walking, and one running. It does look like there has been some improvement here, however, it's still not quite on the same level as Sony's or Canon's autofocus tech. But it's nice to see Panasonic making improvements. Panasonic have also said that they have improved the IBIS by an extra half a stop. We shot a few tests from the back of my car, tracking Joe in his car around the estate. The IBIS in this camera is great, but when paired with Panasonic's IS-enabled lenses, it is remarkable. With the paid firmware, they have added a decent amount of features to make shooting video much better. One of which is the addition of a 10-bit waveform. This obviously really helps when exposing. The only thing I did notice was when outputting information to our Atomos Shogun Inferno, the waveform was not being output. This may be annoying for users using external monitors that don't have this function built in, but not so much when recording externally. The DMW-XLR1, which is a great way to up your audio game with the GH5 and the S1, has also received an upgrade. This update brings improvements to the overall audio quality, upping it to 96 kHz in 24-bit. Now, let's move on to the meat and potatoes of the paid update, the new recording codecs and Vlog. The addition of the 10-bit codecs and log together makes sense. Manipulating footage with 8-bit color in log modes has its pitfalls, which 10-bit resolves. With the addition of Vlog, Panasonic have stated that you can now capture 14 stops of dynamic range. You now have the ability to also load in LUTs into the camera. However, this isn't an easy process. Panasonic use VLT as their LUT format, which means you have to either create VLT LUTs through Resolve or use a piece of software like LUTCalc to convert your favorite 3D or cube LUTs to VLT. Once you have this, there are then a few extra hoops you've got to jump through. You'll need to copy the VLT onto the root of your SD card and then rename it so the name is no longer than 3 letters. If it's longer than 3 letters, the camera will not see it. You can then eject your media, plug it into the camera, and then hop onto the second tab, head down to the monitor / display 3 page, and click on Vlog View Assist. The Read LUT File option will allow you to now ingest the LUT, select your media type, the LUT you want to import, and then you can select which one of 4 slots you'd like to save it to. Once loaded, you can then head into the LUT Select and choose your LUT there. Bear in mind, these LUTs will not affect your waveform when using Vlog, and they will not be recorded onto your footage. This gives you as much data to manipulate in post with the added benefit of being able to monitor in whatever LUT you'll likely be starting your coloring process with. We got a chance to shoot over the weekend, so we traveled down to Chichester Skate Park and filmed with our friend Jordan. The main 2 setups we had were handheld and mounted onto the Ronin S. Our primary lens was the Laowa 12mm, which we've just released our video on, so make sure you check it out. We recorded both internally and externally. Being able to record 4K 4:2 10-bit up to 30 frames a second at 150 megabits a second internally is quite an achievement for such a small camera, and the footage out of it looks really good. The 10-bit files are nicely manipulated in post, and the dynamic range looks stellar, considering the class it's aimed at. However, you can get a little bit extra out of the camera by pairing it with an Atomos external recorder that can handle 4K 60p, like the Ninja V or Inferno. This will allow you to capture 4K 4:2 10-bit at up to 60 frames a second. The only downside to shooting above 50 or 60p in this format is the APS-C crop that is applied. This is the case if you're shooting internally and externally, unfortunately. There is one benefit to that crop mode, however, and that's the ability to use APS-C lenses. Overall, the S1 was already a great choice for videographers wanting a full-frame alternative to the fantastic GH5 or GH5S. But with the new firmware, this camera is a serious choice for people wanting a video workhorse with a great log format, amazing in-camera stabilization, excellent image quality, and great noise performance. But with the S1H around the corner, how will it compete? Well, We'll let you know as soon as we have the S1H in-house, so make sure you subscribe for that.